If you can believe it, Christmas is upon us and we are about to say goodbye to another year. As we look ahead to the future, it's also a worthwhile endeavour to look back at the year that was. Also, because it's easy to forget all that happened. From demographic changes to political events, from social trends to consumer shifts and technological transitions, we're discussing it all today. And by all, I mean just some of the memorable societal events and how we can prepare for what is to come next. And so to help me reflect on this in today's episode is McCrindle's Managing Director, Sophie Renton. Soph, welcome back to the podcast. Great to have you on as always.
Thanks, Ash.
It's going to be a fun kind of episode too, and even as we were both preparing to kind of look back on all that happened this year and as we were doing some desktop scoping and research and speaking to our team today, even it was like, oh yeah, I forgot that this happened or that we had this big event happen. But before we get into those sorts of things, Soph, how's your year been? Any personal or professional highlights as you reflect on 2022?
Yeah, 2022 has actually been a really good year, I think. And we have, touch wood, not had COVID lockdowns in Australia really so far, or none that have been particularly memorable. I think what I have really enjoyed for 2022 has been getting back out speaking in person again, being face-to-face with clients, traveling internationally, traveling domestically, getting close to the 30 flights this year, just getting out and about, having life return back to normal and being able to be face-to-face people, engaging in, I was going to say a whole new way, but actually in the old-fashioned way, in the way that we used to pre the past few years. What about you though, Ash? I know you've definitely gone international. You've been traveling Italy this year and doing some incredible things for work, but any personal or professional highlights?
Yeah, it's a bit of a kind of both and all in one with that Italy-Portugal trip. It was, yeah, amazing to go over and speak at some conferences in Europe and just to be traveling internationally again after, for me, having a couple of trips, as you know, well know, Soph, like postponed or cancelled at sometimes like the final hour. And so went into a few of those kind of engagements, especially international, with a bit of like trepidation. And I was like, I'm not going to get my hopes up because it's very on trend to have these things in my life get cancelled. But they all, not all, but some of them, that Italy, Portugal trip went ahead. And like you, yeah, nothing like being out and about. We've got, I'm coming when we film my part of the podcast in our kind of custom built studio. And we were like giving that a real workout last year. And it's been great to have that again this year. Sometimes people still opt for the virtual engagement. And we love to do that because it doesn't require us to travel as much. But yeah, you gain so much by being in the room with people and hearing their laughter and knowing if the jokes have landed and actually getting to network with people and meet people like face to face that we'd only been speaking to online for so long. So incredible to be back out and about. I think, yeah, that was definitely a bit of a personal and professional highlight. And you know better than anyone, Soph, that this last year we've conducted a lot of research. You are the mastermind behind a lot of our sort of big set McCrindle thought leadership reports, and we're already, especially you, are already busy. I know at the moment in this week that we're recording, kind of planning everything for next year. As you reflect on 2022, do you have any particular studies or projects or events that stood out to you that are quite memorable for you?
Well, if anyone has listened to any of the podcasts, which hopefully you guys have, you'll know that I'm always on the workplace and culture ones. So I think a highlight for me has definitely been our hybrid workplaces study and creating a cultural health index to help leaders, I guess, put a number on culture, to be able to measure something that's intangible so that people can actually identify the points of change that are needed. Because unless you've got clarity on what you need to change, it's like you're just throwing mud at something and hoping it's going to stick. And so that was like a tool with it we created to help people identify, give clarity, and then they can focus their actions to try and actually bring about positive change to create healthy teams, because that's what we love. You wrote a book on work well-being. I know you absolutely love this space as well, and I use lots of those insights when I was pulling that report together. But that's probably definitely been a highlight. I think one of the other ones that I've found so interesting this year, I'm still not sure whether it's a highlight or not, but it's been interesting, is we did a very quick snapshot study on acceptance, just a few questions, but we asked Australians how they defined acceptance. And we also did this in 2020. So just 2 years difference. And that has just brought about vast differences. And there was a whole range of answers that people could do. But essentially it was acceptance is I accept the individual, but I don't necessarily accept what they do, all the way down to I accept the individual and I advocate for their worldview or their practice. And that sense of acceptance is only acceptance when someone is advocating on behalf of a worldview and practice. That is about 8 times more likely to be held in 2022 than in 2020. So in 2020, it was only about 2% of the population thought that's what acceptance was. That's gone up to about 16%. But what's fascinating is that our younger generation are really driving that. So Gen Z, about a third of them view acceptance as accepting the individual and advocating for their practice or worldview, compared to just 6% of baby boomers. So it just is highlighting this really interesting space that we are seeing on what defines acceptance, advocating, identity, which I think as we reflect on this year, that there has been a lot of discussion on that. And I think this stat kind of gives some insight into the mindset shifts that are happening behind that and the generational differences that are occurring behind that. So it's definitely an interesting space to watch.
Yeah, absolutely. And that report that you firstly mentioned around hybrid and thriving culture and decentralized working environments, it's just so relevant, and it's all over LinkedIn and everyone's talking about it because, as we've, I think, talked about on this podcast before, it's now kind of open floor, open plan in the way that people now get to shape what their organization looks like. There's no mandate about you have to do it like this now to keep everyone safe. It's like, okay, well, it's back to normal or back to your new normal. So helping them navigate that has been really cool. And yeah, the whole acceptance piece is really fascinating. One really interesting one, even just to see such a kind of big in the like statistics sort of world, research world, to see that shift even just over 2 years is really interesting. And we touched on that, I think, in the cancel culture kind of episode we did with Mark a few months ago, just around some of the implications of that. And not that it was necessarily all about cancel culture, but it kind of does relate in terms of how we accept other people who have differences to us and what that's looking like for the emerging generation. So really great research. And I think for me, I mean, it's probably because I've been presenting on it, I know you have as well a lot, is I just love our education future research. It's always got that generational lens on it, and we'll be presenting a lot of that, actually, you and I and our speaking team, at a lot of school PD days early next year. And even just that stat around only 14% of school leavers today expect to engage in traditional employment. I mean, that's one of the stats I think that I find so interesting. And I love to, I was, you know, at a family barbecue on the weekend and talking to a nephew of mine, or like second nephew, I think, my husband's kind of cousin nephew. And he was talking about him's going into year 12, and we're talking about what he was going to do and what kind of pathway he was going to pursue. And it's just interesting to see what people's perception is of their working life as they sort of, before they even start it. So really interesting stuff. Always the generations are relevant to us. And I guess, you know, we study human behavior, we study people, and it's a really interesting time of year to stop and pause and reflect on the year that was. And I mean, we don't gather this kind of data, but some other organizations do, particularly Google has released their sort of most Googled terms for the year. So it's fascinating to see a really interesting kind of mix of the most searched terms for Australians overall. So we should just run through what they are before we discuss them. So let's start at number 10. We'll work our way down to number one. So number 10, Betty White. Number 9, Olivia Newton-John. Number 8, Ash Barty. Number 7, Ashes. Number 6, Novak Djokovic. Number 5, Ukraine. Number 4, Shane Warne. Number 3, World Cup. Number 2, Australian Open. And number 1 was Wordle. What are your reflections on that interesting mix of personalities, people that we've lost, sadly, sporting events, and Wordle? Were you surprised by Wordle? I was surprised by Wordle.
I was a little surprised by Wordle that it was the number one. I think, like, people are definitely playing it. It's been around, but to have it as the absolute number one word that Australians have Google searched this year, I do find fascinating. It might be an indication, though, of Australians' own laziness, that they don't actually just bookmark Wordle and every day they look it up, or they don't download the app. I think when I look at it overall, though, it's quite interesting that it does have a game as the number one, then it's sport, then people that we've lost, there's a war in there as well. It really does highlight, I guess, some of the vast variety of experiences that Australians and people around the globe have really walked through and experienced this year.
Yeah, absolutely. I think as well for me, I mean, I think whenever we've done this sort of analysis of the most Googled terms in the past, Australia is a sporting nation and that comes through in this. It's often we are Googling a lot of sport terms or sport personalities. But I think they, and Google runs through kind of, that's just the top overall search terms, and they've got news events, they've got Australian figures particularly, they've got people that we've lost. And even within that, people that we've lost, number four was Queen Elizabeth. And I mean, as Australia is part of the Commonwealth, you know, that was just such a big global event, but for us as well, particularly down under, and to see all the news coverage that it did receive, part of me goes, oh, I'm surprised it wasn't in the overall search terms. But then I'm also like, well, maybe people didn't need to search it because it was just everywhere. Like, it was so easy to access information on it, because for like a week straight, every news piece was about the Queen. So were you surprised that she wasn't in the most overall search terms?
I think similar to you, it's a little bit surprising that she wasn't there. But the coverage of that significant historic occasion was so vast and so frequent that, yeah, you didn't have to go looking for that information. It came to you, not you having to go to it. So it is, it is interesting. And it's been a big year as we reflect on, you know, the passing of the Queen. That really is the end of an absolute era at that time. And King Charles coming in, I think so many people were wondering, is he actually going to get to become king in his lifetime? But he has, and we'll start to see the flow on of that flow through our world. But it's been a really fascinating year.
And we touched on, or we always touch on in our podcast, in our presentations, the topic of demographics, because I mean, we started with the most searched terms. It's fun. It's really interesting. Demographics can get overlooked maybe by the general population, because maybe people
don't. Not by us.
Not by us, but by the general population, just in terms of it's maybe not as fun or exciting or interesting. But we know and we believe that demographic insights and impacts have big impacts. And it's an area that we obviously study a lot. There's been a few kind of demographic things that have happened this year. I mean, one of the big ones would be that we've had the census results come out, and you were filling in for me on that podcast episode because I was away. And so I think that was you and Jeff and Mark did a whole episode on that. Again, I was kind of like out of the country, so missed that kind of fun/stressful
time. Lying on
time.
A beach in Italy. We can't hold that too far against you.
I know, I was like...
And working hard, presenting at international conferences, doing your great advisory keynotes, you know, all about balance here.
I know. And I was like, I was sad in some ways to miss that buzz, because it's that once in a 5-year snapshot. And again, you might go, no, Ash, it's not all rosy colored glasses. It was late nights, a couple of late nights, you know, getting all the data, because we were pretty quick to market with those insights with our event and with the podcast.
2 days later, an event. I don't know if we'll necessarily do that again.
Which is only once in every 5 years that we kind of get that. So it's a big deal. But I mean, other things that I think about more recently, the global population ticked over 8 billion people, and we did an episode on that. We found from the census that we've got a bit of a changing of the guard with the generations. We've now got millennials, which is our generation, the generation that both of us belong to, overtaking the baby boomers as Australia's largest generation. And we've got some interesting kind of internal migration patterns going on. I mean, now borders are open again, and Australia relies very heavily on net overseas migration. So places like Melbourne and Sydney are growing through that sort of source of population growth. But then you've got Queensland, which has been in the news recently, just being a real benefactor of people leaving the other states, particularly Queensland, particularly Victoria and New South Wales moving up north. Were they any things that stood out to you, Soph? I mean, as I said, you were really at the front and center of this census one we did. How was that as you reflect on, 2022?
Yeah, the census is incredible. It is a once in every 5-year occasion. And, you know, while I make the joke of maybe we won't do that again, we 100% will. We loved it. It was a great buzz. Like, we are nerds, we embrace it, but we love the power of data because it really does tell the story of people. And the census is a national snapshot that gives us that five-year change. And, you know, we got the data, we got to dig into it, we got to find the stories and be able to design that up and present that to people just 2 days later. But to help them understand actually what's going on in Australia and not just through spreadsheets or overwhelming data sets, but through pictures and stories, because we love taking data and helping people actually engage with it. So I loved the census. It was a real buzz moment for our team. We had cake, we celebrated, we definitely got that nerd on, but it highlighted some really interesting stories, like what you said about generational change, that millennials are overtaking, that they are the largest population in Australia, the differences on the way that we work, our health, the proportion born overseas. Australia is an incredibly diverse nation, and we can really snapshot that through the census data and dig into that and understand landscapes and areas in a whole different way. And I think it's an incredibly powerful tool that we have in Australia that is actually it far exceeds the free data sets that are actually available in many other countries. So census was definitely a highlight, but I also loved the 8 billion global, because we're not just about Australia here at McCrindle. While that might be where we are largely based, we love global demographics. We love exploring how our entire world is changing, and being able to celebrate that moment of 8 billion people was a pretty special one.
Yes, it was. We often have, you know, population milestone celebrations here, and yeah, it's to tick over another billion people in the world is very exciting. And even as we think local and national here, but also global, 2022 was a interesting year, kind of economically and politically. I mean, here in Australia, we gained a new prime minister. We've seen lots of global political events take place, like over in the UK and even in the US. We've had, of course, the war in Ukraine, and that's had big impacts geopolitically, but even flow-on effects, even like at a consumer sort of economic level around interest rate rises, cost of living rises, inflation. I was talking about this recently actually with Mark, and he was mentioning that there definitely seems to be this mood of consumer anxiety at the moment around inflation, around interest rate rises, and just the general economic uncertainty, even I guess as we approach Christmas, around maybe more of a subdued Christmas spend, because we've all been impacted by some of the rises in cost of living lately. Does that all come to mind for you, Soph, when you think about 2022 and that sort of economic, global, political sort of year that we've had?
100%. I think it would be rude of us almost to dismiss this year without, or finish this year without acknowledging some of the significant challenges that it has been for many people. Interest rates rising just a tiny bit have significant ramifications. The cost of electricity, the cost of petrol, the cost of food, that has gone up significantly for the fresh food, the availability of it. We used to have this life where we would just go to the supermarket and expect it to always be full. We had never, particularly our generation, had never really experienced a time when it wasn't like that. And so over the past few years, we've had that disrupted. And I think as people went, oh, like COVID's over. I say that very not and with the speech marks around it. Yeah. It's people, I think, were almost so hopeful or so expecting a little bit of normal or a bit of precedented times. And yet the challenge continues with the rising cost of living. And yeah, it's really around that uncertainty. And it really is drawing on people's levels of resilience. But as people are tired, that I guess step back up is getting harder and harder for people to do. And I think people are feeling weary at the end of this year. And we saw that even with the word of the year. We were talking about this in the office. I'm going to let you say this one because it is such a fascinating one. But yes, over to you, the word of the year.
Yeah, so people will know if you've ever seen a McCrindle presentation that we like to kind of paint a picture of, you know, mainly in our introductions, like a fun way of looking at the maybe last decade or the last couple of years around the word of the year that mainly the Oxford English Dictionaries put out. And their word of the year in the past has been, you know, fun things like selfie. And then it kind of went to the word toxic back, I think, in 2017. And we had climate emergency in 2020. There was like five or six different words, including things around the pandemic like lockdown and COVID-19, but also Black Lives Matter and cancel culture. Last year, the word of the year was vax. And this year in 2022, in a quite an interesting move, I think, well, as from what I've read and researched, it's the first time that the public has voted on the word of the year. So the Oxford English Dictionaries team haven't just kind of made the call on it, but people have actually chosen it. And they've chosen goblin mode. Goblin mode. and I read that and I was like, oh, sorry, what? And so I've done a little bit of research on it. And while the meaning is not immediately obvious to anyone, it describes a type of behavior which is unapologetically self-indulgent, lazy, or greedy, typically in a way that rejects social norms and expectations. So an interesting one. And I was reading up an article which was quite interesting on The Atlantic about it. And it was interesting because, you know, even that they kind of go into the history of the term goblin, and they're like, goblins represent the impish, unself-consciousness of our private lives. They're ugly little monsters who love making mischief around the home. They've more fun than trolls because instead of waiting under a bridge to hurt someone, they're just chilling at the crib, looking nasty and getting up to no good. Maybe they haven't showered in a few days, but they're not evil. They just want to stay in and play. Sound like anyone you know? And I think it's interesting because when you see some of the kind of visual representations, it's kind of that, like, it's a goblin, but they're like on their lounge with their phone and their snacks. And it's just that self-indulgent kind of maybe response to the fact that we've been in lockdown for a couple of years, enforced into our homes. And then it was like the gates were open, and we kind of touched on it with a bit of a less kind of popular phrase, but like, if you remember, we talked about HOGO, the hassle of going out. It was kind of like, we've had to build up our ability to network and connect. And even when we came out of lockdown for the first time, it was always like, are we shaking hands? Are we hugging? Are you feeling safe with this? Like, do I need to wear a mask? And so it's kind of that idea that we've this counter trend, almost what this Atlantic article calls unbridled domestic liberation, or a complete shedding of the mask of public life. Or they also said just staying home and getting weird. And they said, whatever you call it, this journalist said they're grateful for their newfound ability to go goblin mode. Now get out of my house so I can act unhinged. So I feel like if anyone's listening and they're ready for, you know, it's been a big year, December's a busy time. If you need some time at home, you know, there's many people around the world as well who are activating their goblin mode.
There definitely are. And I think in response to all the technological, the global, the social challenges, you can definitely understand why goblin mode has arisen as a, I guess, an outlet for people, or a place where they just go, you know what, it's all too hard and I'm just going to activate my inner goblin.
Absolutely. And we were looking at some of the other, because kind of different dictionaries, popular global dictionaries, also put out their own kind of words of the year. So other honorable mentions about the word of the year for 2022 that also could be noted include Merriam-Webster's word of the year, which was gaslighting, which, if people don't know, that's described as the act or practice of grossly misleading someone, especially for one's own advantage. And the Collins word of the year was permacrisis, so a term that describes an extended period of instability and insecurity. So lots of fun things to reflect on over the year, but also a bit more of a somber tone around some of those, I guess, economic, political, even the way we're just responding to the last couple of years. And I think even the impacts of, like, the longer lasting impacts of the pandemic, even though we're now out of time of lockdown, there's still some behavioral changes that our research has been exploring this year, even around work, but even beyond that into our kind of personal lives. And then, of course, economically as consumers with inflation and rising cost of living. So, yeah, an interesting year to be alive and to reflect on. Absolutely. I think as well, we know we often talk about, and it's a really interesting, obvious marker of change, is the technological change that we've seen. And I think we're probably in an era now when we're living through it that we probably don't even realize, because it's evolving like in our hands with our iPhones and our Spotify playlists and all those ways that artificial intelligence kind of outworks. It can be hard to keep up. I mean, Sophie, do you have any reflections on the technological landscape or social media landscape, just as we reflect on 2022?
I think TikTok is the biggest mention in the social media landscape. It has grown astronomically this year, and particularly with the younger audiences, and businesses are looking at ways that they can engage on TikTok to engage with the next generation. What's really fascinating when we look at TikTok, though, is the sense of content creation on it, that there are a lot of consumers, but people are creating that content as well. And they are doing it in such a way that is authentic, that it's driving home. It's not about perfection, but it's about the reality. And maybe it's actually a platform for expressing the inner goblin mode that we are seeing just accelerated across the world. And So I think that's really interesting to just even just pause and go, okay, why do we think TikTok has picked up so much? And I think it is that real drive for authenticity. It's that real drive to go, we want to be seen, we want to be known, we don't want facades anymore. And the younger generation are using whatever medium is in their hand to be able to convey that. We've seen Be Real take off this year around similarly, again, the authentic self. And so you always have, I guess, those trends and counter trends where Instagram, when it first started off, it was this illusion of perfection, the highlights reel, and it still has that to a degree, but their stories and everything else that they've brought in has been driving that authenticity. And so we've got this happening in our individual social media landscape. But then as we think about technology as a business perspective, it is incredibly challenging for businesses out there as we think about the cybersecurity breaches, as we think about the rise of AI, as we think about the need to leverage technology in an uncertain economic environment. Leaders need to keep up to date with the evolving technology so that they can leverage that in this current climate. And that is incredibly challenging because the introduction of different technologies into businesses doesn't typically happen overnight. There's often quite a process to that. So on the individual side, we see this real drive for authenticity. And then on the business landscape, it's increasingly one of complexity and trying to figure out how all the different technological platforms fit together to really leverage and bring about change. So it's an interesting one, the technology landscape, and it's only going to increase the integration of it in our lives.
Yeah, I think you've pulled out some really interesting observations there, Soph. I definitely have seen that as well around the changing kind of vibe on social media from, maybe a decade ago, definitely, when Instagram, well, even beyond a decade ago now, but when it launched and it was that picture perfect vibe, and now it's Gen Z's coming in on TikTok going, we don't want your picture perfect, highly edited kind of highlights. We want more of the authentic, the real, like you said, the gobbler mode. And we saw that even probably with the Be Real, the rise of Be Real, like a new sort of social media platform where people were just sharing their real moments sort of thing. But yeah, I mean, again, from a business perspective, artificial intelligence and the rise of that. And I think we're going to see that probably even more so, obviously, as time goes on, but even into next year, just how that's progressing and how organizations can utilize that and use that to their advantage. But also the privacy concerns. I mean, it's just plagued the media for the last 6 months. And I don't know many people as consumers who haven't been affected in Australia by one cyber sort of security breach or another with some of the big sort of players involved there. So yeah, some interesting ones. And as I was reflecting on a much lighter note, I was thinking about social media trends and I was like, what one could be fun to draw out? And I mean, gosh, there is a new social media trend every day, every hour. But one that sticks out to me was the corn song. Remember that song with that little boy singing that corn song? So anyway, if you remember that, that's a fun memory of 2022. But as we look ahead, I mean, we've spent most of the episode today looking back at 2022 of our year in review, but we as futurists always love to look to the future. And I didn't want to give too much away because firstly, we're going to be conducting a event at the beginning of next year where we're going to reveal our top trends for 2023. And we'll do a little bit of a podcast highlights episode on that as well. So keep your eye out on our socials and our website for information about that. But without giving too much away, Soph, is there a trend or a topic that you're keeping your eye on as we look to 2023?
I think the trend or topic that I'm really keeping an eye on is this one around how we have a healthy society, how we have healthy public discourse, because we've not necessarily seen that done exceptionally well this year. And there's this tension, and we always love to talk about the tensions, but the tension of the representation of the authentic self, of standing on convictions, of holding your viewpoint, of advocating for your viewpoint. Yet, how do we learn how to allow and create space for others to do the same? How do we maybe choose to respond with empathy rather than being quick to rise to offense, but to lead with empathy and to go on the journey to understand another's perspective so that we can actually find those points in the middle where we can have a healthy conversation rather than having so much friction? So it's maybe not so much a trend, but just something as a social researcher, as a behavior observer, as a people observer, that's something that I just see in society and I go, gosh, we've got to learn how to do this better so that we have a really healthy functioning society into the future. But what about you? You're always pulling these trends together. Do you have any thoughts on your key trends you're keeping an eye on for 2023?
Yeah, I mean, we've done a whole podcast episode, so I feel like I'm cheating a little bit about this one. But I think even just the realization that many people have kind of dawned on us too, that, you know, Generation Alpha will be hitting their teenage years next year, the oldest of them. So what that sort of means, and as we start to really think about them as having a bit more consumer purchasing power, I mean, we've got some big ideas in the works, which I can't reveal too much about, but just around some of the studies and the outworking of that we can help sort of prepare leaders and educators and even, I guess, global brands who come to us and say, okay, who is this future consumer? What are they going to be like? Because, yeah, yes, the youngest of them haven't even finished being born yet, but the oldest of them are going to be teenagers next year. They're going to start high school next year. So I think that's when we released a bit on that earlier this year, everyone was like, what? Really? Kind of a bit of a shock. So I think that's a generational one that I'm keen to share a bit about. But also I think just the AI space, I'm really intrigued because I feel like it's something that we've been talking about for a long time in our future-focused presentations. And it'd be naive for us to say it's not here, because it is. The artificial intelligence is outworking in all consumers' lives already. But I think if it can go to the next level, and we were even talking about this internally the other day, one of our team who keeps a keen eye on this was saying, oh, it's just predicted to kind of take off. So I'm keen to see what that looks like in 2023 as well. But I mean, before we get there, we do have, as many people do in Australia here anyway, a bit of a break with summer and school holidays. And yeah, this will be probably our final episode of the podcast for the year. So to all our listeners, we did want to wish a very great holiday season, Christmas and New Year, whatever that looks like for you. And I wanted to share as well just something that I read on LinkedIn. It was a post about kind of coming to the end of the year. And I think just after our conversation today, Sophie, I've also just been reminded that a lot of people are feeling pretty exhausted, and that's pretty natural to feel at the end of a year because we're kind of pushing towards the end of the year. Even our team meetings this week, we're like, all right, guys, we're almost there, but we just got a bit more to go. We've got to get through the work and that sort of thing. But this LinkedIn post kind of shared this perspective that not many people began this year on a full tank anyway, in light of kind of this shared trauma of the last 2 years of lockdown and that kind of that almost like central nervous system just constantly being ready for something else to go wrong. And I mean, it's helpful in some ways to build that resilience and to be ready for unexpected events and unprecedented times. But I guess it's also relating to the fact that many people are feeling pretty worn out and burnt out perhaps. This post just read, and it said, before you begin questioning the absolutely depleted and wrung dry state you are in, hopefully you can use this time to pause, breathe, and remind yourself of who you are and what you have endured over the last year, and then remind yourself of what you've overcome. You're still going. Understanding brings compassion. Instead of racing to the finish line, it is an option for us to kind of tread gently. And I just wanted to share that because I feel like as we look back on the year that we've all lived through, there's been a lot that we've covered today, and there's a lot that we've all collectively gone through. And so hopefully we all have an opportunity around December, January to stop and pause and reflect and just breathe and give ourselves some grace, because it's been a big couple of years.
Sure has. Some great advice there.
Well, thank you so much, Soph, for coming on the podcast today, helping us reflect on 2022. Just a snippet, of course, there's no way we could ever cover everything, even if this podcast was a few hours long, but it's been great to just point out some of those sort of demographic, economic, social, generational, political kind of highlights that we tend to structure our content and our presentations around. So always such a delight to have you and your wisdom on the podcast. So thanks for joining us today.
Thanks for having me, Ash.
And if you'd like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, perhaps over your break, if you've got one coming up, you can subscribe to the podcast, listen back to some previous episodes. You can follow us on social media, or you can head to McCrindle.com or GenerationAlpha.com if you're keen to find out more about this generation about to hit their teen years. So once again, thank you for listening, and bye for now.